Hi everyone, my name is Jessie from the Fragrance Foundation UK and welcome to today's Midday Masterclass. Today's session is with MMI Analytics and it's all about how to increase your brand media return on investment by maximising your e-commerce conversion rate. MMI offer informed decisions to help grow your beauty brand. They monitor and measure your influencer and online retail relationships by using beauty industry data to build targeted brand strategies. With the UK beauty industry expected to spend over £600 million on media this year, it is important to ensure you have the right e-commerce plans and tactics to convert shoppers. In this 30-minute session, MMI Analytics will discuss the critical etail conversion drivers and how to maximise them. And so, with that being said, I'm delighted to welcome from MMI, Kevin, Business Unit Director of etail, who will lead this session with a wealth of experience. I'm really looking forward to today's session. So welcome, Kevin.
Thanks, Jessie. Perfect. Yeah, so a bit about myself. So 13 years in the industry. Started at P&G Prestige, where I was in sales and in UK sales specifically for a number of years. I finished my career in P&G Prestige in a global e-commerce lead role for P&G Prestige. So that's where I really got into e-commerce. And then for the past 5 years, I've been as part of joining Coty and managing the UK Lux sales team. I had a specific focus on e-commerce as part of that team as well, where we built an e-commerce team and got very focused about driving our conversion in that area as e-commerce continued to grow. So over all that time, and I'd probably say over the last 10 years where I've worked in e-commerce in some work form or another, data has been key. So what's great about online, and there are many downsides to online, as we know, the impact it's having on stores, but what's great about it is you can measure almost everything. And that's why I joined MMI, because after using data and many providers for a number of years, I see a good opportunity to kind of make sure we're very commercial with the data we provide. So it's kind of providing data, but not for data's sake, putting a commercial lens on all of that. Okay, Jesse, you want to skip? Let's skip two slides. So this one and the next one. Okay. So what am I going to talk today, and what's the purpose of the Midday Masterclass? It's really looking at this shopper journey. We're not going to talk so much. So if I start left to right, first step is recruiting shoppers. I'm not going to dive into the detail on that. That's our media leg of our business. And if you want to understand more on that, we can connect afterwards and put you in touch with the right people in Media MMI. But that's the first step of the journey. So that's where you tend to spend a lot of the money as well. So the majority you spend there, and it's happening there. And what I'm going to talk to you about are the next steps in that journey. So the other two bubbles of share a voice. So what happens when you've attracted the shopper, when they arrive on the retailer site, what are they seeing? So whether that's share a voice of your brand, so can they see your brand on that page? Or if they're searching things on the retailer, what are they seeing linked to your brand? And then the final step is, okay, when you've kept them on that journey and they get down to the last few yards, what are they seeing related to your brand? So images, ratings and reviews, are you in stock, descriptions, titles, all of those elements, so you make sure you complete that journey. And that's what this is about, right? So you attract the shopper, you want them to convert. If you're losing people on that journey, you're going to have less ROI on your investment of media. So that's really what we want to engage in today and talk about that in more detail and what the key drivers are. Okay. So starting with the first slide. So I'm going to take you back to last year. So fragrance launches last year. We've selected five here, covering at least three of the top ones in this discussion. There's two charts on here. One is media reach. So this is, again, data coming that we collect, where we look at the media that's happening over these periods of months. We calculate a reach off the basis of that. So we can tell brands where they're sitting versus their competitors in terms of the reach that they're making. The chart below is etail reach. So that is the reach that you're generating on retailer sites. So it starts from a share of voice calculation, which I'll come on to later. And then we apply a traffic calculation based on those retailers to come up with a reach. So lots of data on here. I'm just going to dive into slide by slide. So if we go to the next slide, I'm going to start with the biggest, so the two biggest launches of last year. So we've got My Way, and I'll come on to Perfect, but hopefully build the visibility that you can see, and then therefore what are the opportunities when you look at this data together. So going back to the first chart, it's about generating an interest. Sorry, I didn't mean click back to the first pass, Jesse, thanks. It's about generating that interest for your brand. So you spend your money on your media, you've captured them. In this scenario, My Way started that in September and continued a good story along right up till December. Actually, but then when you look down at the etail reach and share a voice, what you see is that slowly drifting down and drifting off. So less reach, less share of voice in the retailer. So therefore the danger with that is you're capturing the shopper, they're arriving at the retailer, but they're seeing something else. And the question is, are they changing their mind? And what you want to be doing, and if I go on to the next slide, Jesse, with Perfect, you have the opposite thing happening. So a lot less media. Everyone started with the big bang in September, but the media drops off significantly on Perfect. One thing to highlight, this doesn't cover TV. So this is online, just so we're clear. You see that dropping away on Perfect. But however, the share of voice in the retailer is growing and increasing. And again, as we work with our clients and the brands, we basically understand more of this and put some context to this. But the first opportunity you see on both of these big ones are, if My Way had done more share of voice in the retailer, could they have a bigger size of prize at the end of it? We would say yes. Likewise on Perfect, if they had more money to sustain that media throughout in the same way that My Way did, with the share of voice they have on the retailer, they would have ended up with a bigger size of prize. So hopefully this highlights the kind of the thoughts and food for thought you can generate when you start looking at the data in this way. Jesse, just go on to the next slide. Perfect. Another few examples, similar thing here with Valentino, which was a significant launch as well. Good share of voice in media, good share of voice from October, then started to drop off November, December. So again, the opportunity here would be when you look at the data to actually, could there have been more happening within the retailer? Next slide, Jesse. And then coming on to the last two, which paint a different picture completely. And I don't know for sure, but I would suggest that Pooj probably didn't have the media budget to spend on this. It wasn't one of their choices. So therefore you see very little happening on media, but actually they've done an excellent job in terms of share of voice off the back of that. So outstanding share of voice in the retailer, even though they didn't seem to have the money to invest in the media. So made the most of what they had in terms of their resources. Clearly the opportunity is, what could that launch have been if the media was at the scale of some of the other brands that we showed earlier? And then lastly, to come on to Angel Nova, this is probably, and again, I don't want to single out brands or anything, but looking at the data, this would suggest this is the opportunity where media, the digital media teams and marketing teams could be working closely together with sales. As you can see, a number of things that don't make a huge amount of sense here when you look at this combined shopper journey view, where lots of media happening earlier on, not a huge amount of share of voice at any point until December, really, in the retailer. So yeah, the questions would be, okay, why was that? Could there have been done with the JVPs and discussions with the retailer to maximize that share of voice? So again, that's the opportunity you draw from this data. Jesse, just click on the last slide. So I'm gonna move on to the next part of the discussion, which is about the next two steps of the journey in terms of what's happening on retailer sites. But I wanted to leave you with this, which is a quick snapshot of what we're seeing this year. And again, in the same way for our clients, we're having the breakdown of this so they can see how this is playing out. But you can see early on, Michael Kors, very keen on media at the start. So June, July, with that dropping off, Couple of standout things in August, my way going big again on media, and also that following up with share a voice in the retailers. And then the other one is Calvin Klein, which again looks like very little media available or money spent on the media, but focusing very much on trying to maximize their share of voice in the retailers. So I'll leave that one with you. If you want to understand more on that, obviously let's catch up afterwards or reach out to me on LinkedIn, and I'm guessing we'll share emails at the end of this anyway. Okay, so let's move on to the maximizing the media investment when you land on the retailer site. So I'm now going to jump into share a voice, which is a key decision maker, and search. So we go to the next slide. Before I do that, though, I just wanted to call out distribution, and having worked 13 years in beauty, trying to manage grey market and the challenges that come with distribution. I just wanted to say this first. I haven't got all the answers for you. I wish I had. But distribution plays a key part in this journey, because for two reasons. One is, you know, you're investing a lot in media. You may be wanting to drive your brand. If the sales are coming outside of what you measure, you don't really know if that media is paying out. So by not having control of distribution and not really knowing all of the channels that it's being sold in, you can never really understand, okay, what's your true ROI off the back of the investments you're making. So that's a critical piece. The other critical piece is this impacts your ROI, because generally a lot of distribution that's grey market or outside of your control is not generating a return of your investment. It's coming from other places or other countries, and therefore you may not, in your local market, and we're talking UK today, you may not be benefiting from that. So you're spending money and not getting the return. A couple of charts I've just put on here quickly. I did a quick search on Google, so put fragrance sale in, and this is what it turned up. And the majority of Google shopping was a lot of grey players, some core retailers as well, but just highlighting the point that's what people are seeing, that may be using Google as part of this shopper journey. So they may have seen your media and then decided to go onto Google and do some searches, and then therefore may be getting taken to one of these other retailers. The other piece, and again, this is data that we provide, the seller count section on the right. We monitor for a number of clients the exposure of third-party marketplace on Amazon. So just trying to understand, you know, what are the retailers, what are the number of retailers out there that have their brands? Why Amazon? Because it's the biggest beauty online retailer there and the biggest marketplace as well. So it's a good place to go and see and get a handle on your distribution. And what you can see from this report that I ran quickly last week is you have plus 200 individual sellers on the marketplace on Amazon. So this is Amazon itself. This is Amazon marketplace and number of sellers. So that just gives you an idea of the scale of in the UK fragrance business, the number of sellers that are happening on a daily basis. Okay. So let's get back to the journey. So the first step, as I said, share a voice. So this is data that we ran for July and August, linking back to the chart that I showed you. This is looking at percentage share. So it's measuring what the shopper sees and then giving a percentage against each of the brands. So these are all the top launches. July and August, as we said, saw on the previous chart, Calvin Klein were doing a good job at maximizing their exposure along with My Way. On the retailer sites. So the key point here is thinking about your media, and when you're planning your media, if you're spending a lot of money on media and then you go on the retailer websites, this gives you a view of what the shopper is going to see. So if you're down in the kind of 1%, 3% and you're spending a lot of money on media, then to drive traffic, then you need to question, okay, is that the right timing, or I needed to be doing something different around these times? And it comes back to this point about aligning the two. There's one caveat with this is looking at September's data now, this is changing dramatically. So before I ran this, I thought, I'm going to see Packer Abam Phantom. I have to see that, because I see that everywhere in terms of on LinkedIn, and I think we've all seen the great videos and pack shots. What we're seeing now in September is that starting to ramp up in the retailer. So this is a moving feast. This was a first snapshot on the first couple of months, but as we go through and lead up to Christmas, we expect to see this change. But the key point here is, have you planned this alongside your media? So is this, there is an intentional plan with media and the share of voice so you maximize your sales. Okay, next slide. Next one is search and rankings on pages. So I've, there's two screenshots here. One on the left-hand side, I just went onto Boots and put fragrance for women in on the Boots website. And this is what it showed. The key point here is, and I'm not gonna go through the detail of it, is first question is, do you know in your retailers the algorithms, how these work? Do you know where you rank versus key search terms, both branded and unbranded search terms? That's all data that you can get. And I don't want to keep plugging MMI, but that's data that's available that you can understand and see where you sit on that. It's significant because the data sets 28% of sales are attributed to on-site search. So this isn't a small, this isn't something that rarely gets used. People are using search a lot. So you need to make sure in this shopper journey, have you got this covered? And are you where you want to be in line with expectations? The second picture is from the perfume shop. And this was not a search, but it was clicking on their main men's fragrance page, so the homepage. And again, do you know where you track on that? This one looks a bit more in line with what I would have expected. So this looks like top seller based, because you have Sauvage, Paco and Boss Bottled on there, versus the Boots one that looks a bit more random, and there may be some algorithms linked to value or offers that they're showing the offers up more. But again, the key takeout here is this matters. So people use this, therefore, are you aware of how it works? And are you talking to your retailer about how do you maximize your exposure and your share of voice in this part of the journey? Okay, next slide. Okay, so that's the first step. So we've covered, you know, landing on the retailer. What are you seeing in the initial searches on homepages? Is your brand awareness as it should be on the basis of the amount of money you're spending on media and the timing that you're spending that media? Now we get into the last step of the journey, which is you've kept them, you've recruited them, you've kept them interested through the first steps through the retailer. Now they're coming down to say, okay, I need to make a purchase decision now and I'm gonna buy brand X. How does that look for the shopper? And do you have any risk areas or concern areas that might mean that after all of that effort, you haven't converted them and they haven't purchased the product? So if we go to the next slide, I'm going to start with this one, because if you don't have the product, then no one can buy it. It's pretty straightforward. It's when I ran this data. So again, this is looking at September last week. In a lot of these, I'm going to use examples of the top five fragrance players as per MPD. So I'm going to take it through that lens. I appreciate that doesn't cover all of the brands where people are on the call, and we can follow up afterwards if you want to know more on your specific brand. But it gives a flavor, because of the scale of these companies and brands, what's going on out there and the opportunities. So so if stock's not there, the idea that the shopper will say, right, I'm going to go somewhere else. I'm going to find it because I must get that brand. Yeah, fragrances and a lot of beauty is, you know, there's a gifting element to it. So yes, there's a loyalty part to it, but people are buying gifts. There's a high chance that they may have a list of gifts or a small number of gifts that they're planning for Christmas. So I use fragrance as an example again. They may say, actually, well, it's out of stock here. I'm going to go to number two in the list. The data actually suggests, and it's well documented, that 60% of the shoppers switch to another item due to out of stocks. I don't have that specific data for the fragrance industry, but I can expect it's at a high level. The first thing that stood out to me when I ran the data is, you know, there's a significant amount of out of stock. So this is looking at all the SKUs that we're tracking in fragrance, and it's looking at did they have out of stocks over that period? So I know everyone knows this, but yeah, step one is working with a retailer, working with your supply teams and making sure that you have stock available for people to buy. Otherwise, you're going to lose that opportunity straight away. Next slide. Next one is images and videos. So a couple of stats before we go into the numbers. So conversion rate doubles when using three images versus one. So images matter a lot. So just having one image is not good enough, and the shopper expects more than that. Best practice is five. And looking at the numbers when I ran this, and again, it's averages. So yeah, there were, believe it or not, there are some brands on some websites that have 11 images. So more than what's needed, that skews some of these averages. So we need to bear that in mind. What's clear is there are some that have no images when I looked at the data, a lot that have one, but because of some of the higher numbers of 11, 10 images, we get to an average that looks okay, but there's still lots of opportunities there. When we come to videos, videos are becoming more and more important. The latest data is 64% of customers make a purchase after watching a video. This is probably the biggest opportunity area, as you can see from the numbers. There's a big opportunity across all of the companies and all of the brands and retailers as well, that we could be doing more here to increase our conversion and get people more engaged in the brand. And often what you see is, you know, they'll see some great videos in the media, they'll see some great engagement in the media, that keeping them on that journey and managing those expectations as they go through the journey to keep seeing that level of content, that's the challenge here. And it looks like our face value of it, video seems to be the area that we need to develop in. Next slide. Next one is share of voice and conversion that's impacted by discounts and GWPs. So I think we can all safely say if you discount a SKU, you're going to convert more. It's pretty safe to say that. Anyone that's worked in sales or in a retailer sees the spikes when we discount brands. The one I wanted to call out here is share of voice, because what we see in the data, both for discounts and I'll come on to GWPs, is these are triggers that allow you to increase your unpaid share of voice. Now, I'm not sitting here and saying discount more of your SKUs. We can tell by the numbers we're already in a good place on that one. But just so you're aware, you see share of voice increasing because you might be in a multi-brand promotion that's driven by the retailer. Therefore, they want to shout about your brand. So those are the opportunities on discount. If you're discounting, is that visibility of discounting playing out online? I guess I'd push you more towards the GWP area, because I think added value versus money off is probably a better way to manage your brand equity. But again, on this, for share of voice, what we see in the data is unpaid share of voice happening because the retailer has an exclusive GWP or has a GWP that they want to shout about, in which case you get an unpaid share of voice rather than, in a number of cases, paying for banners for just brand messages that you might have. So using these tools to increase your share of voice is obviously a big opportunity. I won't say much more on the level of discounting. I mean, it just continues to creep up over the years, but yeah, we're in the high 50% on some of the companies. So yeah, so use these in the right way to drive your share of voice and conversion. Okay, next slide. Ratings and reviews. So yeah, another area that's a great opportunity. I don't know about yourself, but I don't think I buy anything now without reading a review in some shape or form, or even use a website with going on Trustpilot. So reviews are a key part of shopping, and the data here was saying 98%. So I can believe that. But yeah, reviews are a key part of the process, the purchase process now. So you need to understand, again, how are you performing on that? Do you have reviews in place? If you don't have reviews in place, then you can work with sampling, you can work with companies at trying to drive the level of reviews up on your brands. Often we see on new launches, this is a good opportunity and some brands using this as well. So you have a new launch, you've already done the sampling, you've got the reviews before you launch it. So right from the bat, you've got a review number against your new launch, which will encourage people to take a risk on it. Again, yeah, we're working in a highly gifting category in fragrances. And as we see more shift to online, they can't smell it. So if they're buying it online, hopefully they're going into store to smell it. But if they're not, then they're going to be using reviews and ratings to try and make some gifting decisions. So again, it becomes even more critical, I think, in the environment we're in and the category that we work in. Now, the average number of reviews, just going on to the data, minimum of 3 is the guidance. 4.2 is the optimum. You don't really want 5. 4.2 is the optimum rating level. You don't really want 5 rating. People don't believe things are perfect, so 5 isn't the ideal number. And you want to have 40 plus reviews with a minimum of 20 to get the right level of engagement. So I go on to the numbers. The numbers of reviews look big. What we see in a number of the brands is a very high level of reviews, which is skewing the average. I think in one L'Oreal brands that I saw on John Lewis, there was 18,000 reviews. So well done to L'Oreal, but that skews the overall average. I did want to flag that I'd looked at, there were 4,300 SKUs with less than 20 reviews. So there's masses of opportunity in there. The point here would be, can you see that? Are you aware of that? If not, you need the data so you can understand that and then start actioning and start driving those reviews to get those reviews up. The other one is the average ratings, which looks in a pretty good condition. Again, there are quite a few 5s in there. So behind the data, there are a large number with 3 or less. But again, this is the point here is to just highlight these are important. What you want to be doing as brand owners is understanding, okay, what is my brand, my list of SKUs, how am I performing versus this? If I don't have those right targets in place, I need to get them in place because that's going to play a key part in the purchase decision and driving that conversion as we talked. Okay. So coming on to the recommendations and just to wrap up on what I was sharing. So a couple of takeouts for me in terms of what you need to take away from this. So first one was planning your media and e-commerce investment together to maximize ROI. So if I go back to those first charts in terms of, do you have a handle on when the media is running and when your sales team, so digital team, sales team talking to each other to say, I'm going to be doing my media at this time of year. When's the right time? What's the required share of voice that I should be getting or looking to get with the retailer? Then having those discussions with the retailer to let them know this is when we're spending our money on media. So therefore it would be a good opportunity to plan the share of voice in the retailer at the same time. I'd even take this a stage further, and this is, you know, and some businesses are already there, but structurally, do you have a digital team or is it a marketing team, a separate sales team? It's about bringing that under one roof, under one umbrella, so you can have discussions as one team and even start talking about your budgets. So say you can start talking about, I have X amount to spend. So do I spend it all in media and don't spend anything on retailer sites? I do that, I'm likely to lose some of that traffic somewhere through the journey. So is it better that I split this in a way that we cover everything and we keep everyone on the shopper journey as we go? So that's a big next step that if you're not already doing something, you should be looking at. Partner with retailers, I mentioned it there, to improve the metrics and increase the conversion. As I said, 13 years of working in sales on a number of brands, better to partner with together on this, both from a retailer point of view and a brand point of view. You get more out of a partnership rather than trying to trade off, to trying to be, and a lot of this is already happening, right? We have retailers with implants in place, so we can look at these metrics and the shopper journey. We have Google co-funding and co-funding on media. So I'm talking about things that are already in place, but if you're not in that position, I can't say enough about the opportunities and the improved sales that you get by working in partnership rather than trying to work in isolation and trading off. Next one is use data to understand the opportunities and improvements. I would say this because I'm now working for MMI, but as I said, in the 13 years of working in beauty, I've always used data, even more so with online, because actually, I'm sharing a number of metrics here, but you can track mostly anything online. Use the data to build your strategy, look at your plans, understand what your competition are doing as well. So if somebody's winning in the market or their brands are winning, you can learn a lot from what they're doing and see if some of those tactics or strategies can help your brand. Data is key. And the last one is, we've got a peak period coming up for Christmas, so it's not too late to do a lot of the things that we're talking about here. Maybe a bit harder to plan some of TV media, this one that's already booked, but on the online media, you can plan that a lot later. So it's all to play for with Black Friday, Christmas, and calendar year 22 planning. Next slide. So I didn't want to leave without offering a free report. So if you go on hello@mmianalytics.com, we've just run a basic report, which, coming back to this partnership piece between retailers and brands, you can run a report, you'll get a report, sorry, that gives you visibility of those partnerships and where they're happening. So where retailers and brands are being mentioned together in the media. So if you didn't know some of that, so some of this might be stuff that's paid for but unpaid, it will give you a trigger to say, okay, maybe some of the retailers or brands that you should be working closer with. Have that as a free report. Thanks for your time. It was great to have this session, and hopefully I'll see you at the Fragrance Foundation Awards next week. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kevin. That was so wonderful. A really insightful midday masterclass, and I'm sure everyone got so much from that. Thank you as well for offering a free report. I encourage everyone to kind of get in touch. We've had a couple of questions, which I just thought we could touch on very quickly. Sure. So someone is asking, so does media include TikTok? Obviously, there's new platforms all coming out, and so does media include these new platforms, and should we be looking out for them?
Yeah, absolutely. So we track TikTok. It's not in that report that I shared earlier, but we do have reports that we track TikTok. We also have a tool called Influencer Connect, which allows people to find the right influencer on TikTok. So we can look at a number of demographics, what the brands they talk about. My dogs are starting to bark now. So not in that specific report that we ran there, but can we run reports including TikTok? Absolutely.
Yeah. Amazing. And the last question was, how can a small brand with limited budgets have a bigger impact on share of voice?
Yeah, I think it's about, and we get asked this a lot, it's about being targeted, right? So a couple of things I would say. So if you're a smaller brand, it's really understanding, okay, where do you want to sit in the brands that are already out there? So what's your target market? Do you have a brand in mind that you'd like to be like, or that's the market you're going after? Then the start point would be starting then to look at what are they doing if they've been growing, they're a successful brand. So you can start targeting that. So you need to get the data to understand that. Then you can get quite focused. So it might be, I can't spend millions on media, but I might work with one influencer that I know in that arena has the right level of following, can get me some return on my investment. And that's what it's all about. It's about, you've got less money, invest the money, get some return on that, grow your profits, then reinvest and keep building, and it takes time. So first things I would say is, influencers, understand which influencers are out there and would be right for your brand. And then I would start with share of voice, probably measuring that on a retailer wouldn't be the one. I would think probably you probably need to be looking at pricing, and then probably also looking at the fundamentals. So making sure that you've got ratings and reviews, all of those things in place. So at least you complete that last part of the journey.
Amazing. Thank you so much. And thank you everyone for joining us today. Hope you're all looking forward to the awards next week. I'm very excited. And as Kevin said, do get in touch if you have any questions, and Kevin's there to help as well. So thank you so much for your time, Kevin, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Lovely. Bye. Thank you.